right, locks. Now, what I've got on the table here is a series of Ford locks and keys, and quite frankly, what I'm going to be talking about has absolutely nothing to do with Ford locks and everything to do with a pin-type key system that a lot of the manufacturers used back in the 60s. You'll see that I've got two locks here. These are both glove box locks and the load deck lock for the 69 wagon we own. This is a door lock for a Ford, and this is actually a trunk and or on our wagon, a lock for the tailgate on that wagon. So what we've got here is basically a lock system. And honestly, what I'm going to tell you is any one of these keys, as long as you have this type of key for the trunk, which is on the Ford stuff, the round key, you can make any one of the round keys work on any of these locks. And the same thing with the door locks and the ignition. As long as you have a key, you can make the lock work with that key. And the other thing I'll tell you is, quite frankly, you could take all of the pins out of the lock and use it that way as well. It doesn't have to be in there, and nobody's really going to know whether you've got the pins in there or not, because most people just naturally assume that your locks are keyed. And the only thing that this key right here would do is basically just go in there and turn the tumbler set around so that you could unlock the door. That's all it would be for. None of these points on the key would have any kind of interplay with the pins inside of this. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take apart one of these locks and basically re-key it so that we have it working with, oh, let's say, our wagon key right here. Okay, I'm gonna get all the rest of this stuff out of here. Two things that we're gonna be working on, leaving in the table. Now, we're gonna be using a Ford key that we have that already exists on a lock that I know the key won't turn. No motion out of it whatsoever. So we're going to take and open this up. Now, what you'll wanna do is, on most of these style locks, there is a silver plate on the top of this, a U-shaped plate that's made of stainless, and what you need to do is to get that cover off. I'll tell you this, that you have to be very, very careful on removal. I've done enough of these to know that you can booger up the springs that are inside of it. And if you mess those springs up, they're a little bit less likely to be able to put the correct pressure on the pins, which are these little suckers right here. Now, what I've done in the past is I've taken a bunch of these locks and I've pulled everything apart on them so that I can have spare pins laying around. So if I go to the junkyard, I pop a couple of Ford locks off here and there. That way I've got different depth pins, and I should have enough to make this work. So what you want to do is you want to set the pin up on its end and put a very thin flat blade screwdriver in here and push that cap off. Sometimes you may have to use a hammer to get that to come loose, and then carefully you'll want to pry that top off like so, and you can see I have indeed mucked up one of my springs. Darn, kind of a shame. But I am not going to be using all five of these holes because I just don't want to go through the complexity of doing that. And if I did, I have enough spares in here that I could actually do that if I so chose. That right there, if you can see it in super small size, is the spring that we messed up. Inside of these are pins. Now I'm going to take and cover up the other holes and drop out the pin set. Now there are usually two pins down in there. The lower pin is usually capped or rounded. This pin right here is a bottom pin, and you can see that it's got a rounded base on it. That's the piece that goes down in the bottom down here. I'm going to go ahead and start getting the rest of these out. There you go. Now this one you can see both pin sets. You can see the top pin with the shoulder on it and the bottom pin with the standard rounded end on it. Honestly, on this, you are not going to get this on an aftermarket lock. There are no shouldered pins in there. Now, we know this is the second place pin from the back. This is the very back pin. I'm going to continue to move forward, pulling my springs out and laying my pins in the location that they fell out in. Now, if you were just going through and working on a lock, you would need to worry about position. With what we're doing, I don't need to worry so much about position because I'm re-keying the lock. But I'll now be able to use these to make my setup here. And the final one. Spring. You can look at this and tell, even with these other ones here, that there are varying depths on everything. There's a different depth for their locator pin, here and the push pin here. And you can mix and match these things until you are blue in the face. And the best thing to try to do is, if you're going to do this, just kind of work at it. It's going to take a little time, but you're going to be able to pull it together. All I am going to do here on a lock, just to kind of give you an example, is I am maybe going to use one pin off of here just so that you can see what we're doing with this, that you can actually make a functioning lock out of this. So what we're going to do next is we're going to go in and pin this out and show you the operation with the key. Now, what I've done is I've gone in and lubed this up, and I would recommend using graphite lube on any of your locks. You don't want to use anything like lithium or any of these other greases that you could spray down inside there. That's because your key sits on those pins. And that being the case, anytime you put lubricant in there, this a greasy type lubricant, it's going to be on your keys. When you put them in your pocket, guess what? It's going to get all over the inside of your pockets. Now, for ease here, I'm taking the back plate off of this, and it's basically just held on with a circlip. When you put the key in the lock, it goes in like this, should spin freely. And we know that we're going to be putting this in the second position. That's the deepest pin set on here. If I were actually keying this for a car, I would probably do maybe two more positions besides this center one. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put a pin set in there that I have, because I'm just pulling randoms on this just to see what we've got. And immediately, you can see now the pins have dropped down into the hole where they should be. But immediately, we have no operation from the key. It has ceased to function like it was just a second ago. So we know that that pin set is not going to work for us. We're going to have to go and do something else. So we're going to try another pin set. We've got a long, rounded pin and a short retainer pin. Now, you'll also notice on this, if you can see it in the camera here, that pin is a little deeper inside the hole than the other one was. Once you get one of these established, if you have all of these set at the same level inside that hole, you should be good to go. If there's staggered levels in there, your pins aren't set up correctly and it's not going to operate the lock. So we're going to put a spring in there, put some pressure on the spring, and voila, we have operation of our key. We could now put this on the car and use it. And the cool thing is, if you wanted to do this, I don't know if you've got more than one car of the same make, you could actually key all of your cars to operate off of one key. Right, that's how you key a pin type lock system. Now be sure to tune in to us every Thursday for our normal episodes of Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks.